evening. How's everybody this evening? Excellent. My name is Phil Berlini. I'm the Deputy County Executive and Chief Information Officer for the county. And I'm going to kick our program off to talk, was it not, yeah, time. So I'm going to kick our program off to get everything going for you this evening. You're probably wondering why the Chief Information Officer is up here. I used to be the Level 4 Assessor in charge of equalization for the county. So I am also a certified property tax assessor with the state of Michigan. There's a couple of handouts that we had in the front, so did everybody pick up? There's two handouts. There was this handout, which is several sheets. It's a handout that I'll go through in a second. And also we have this blue brochure. Did everybody pick one of those up? If not, they're right up at the front, so if you hold your hand up, we'll have some of our people bring them down to you. How's that? Yeah. And some of those were in the notices that were mailed out. What I'd like to do is explain who is with us here this evening. So I will introduce the folks from Oakland County, and then we will talk about a little bit about what we have in the handouts and also the agenda, and then I'll turn it over to the first person I'm going to introduce is Dave Eber. Dave is the manager of equalization for the county. So he's the top guy over in equalization that handles the assessing for many of the units that we work with. Rick Vincent, back there, is the administrator of equalization. We also have Rob Scripture. Where's Rob at? Rob is in the back. We have John McCarthy. John, who's out handing out some handouts. Ann Grady. Where's Ann? There she is. Ann. Tracy Jones. Tracy. She's in the back as well. Tiffany Jacob. Tiffany's handing out the brochures. And Terry Schultz. Terry's back there. So let me explain a little bit how we're going to do things tonight. And I'll go through the agenda in a second, but we have a program for you to kind of explain the assessing process and what we do as the property tax assessor and what we provide in regard to information. Then we will also have a Q&A period where we'll have some general questions and answers. But all of these people that are here are also here to talk to you about your individual situation. If you have an individual question about your assessment, that's why we have all these folks here from Oakland County to go ahead and hopefully answer those questions for you, okay? So why don't we go ahead and get started? So this property appeals process and this whole workshop came about, this is our third year doing these, but prior to that, we provide orientations and sessions for other entities of government on how we manage government here in Oakland County. We talk about our fiscal needs and some of the budgeting practices that we have. For all of you that I'm sure all from Oakland County, we have a balanced budget through the year 2015. Not too many governments can talk about that. We also are working on a balanced budget for 2016. So we will have one for 13, 14, 15, and 16 when we get through our budget process this spring. Our county executive, Elbrus Patterson, wanted us to go ahead and put on some sessions for other governments to talk about the types of things we do, the types of shared services we do, and programs we work through to help manage our fiscal responsibility to all of you, which are the citizens of our county. So this appeals process, there was a number of legislators here in the state of Michigan that were holding appeals sessions around the county, and we started attending them because we wanted to make sure that the information the taxpayers were getting was the accurate information on what they needed so that they could effectively appeal their assessment. So that's where these workshops were born. They are here to be informational. I'm sure you've heard the story, right? We're here from the government. We're here to help you, right? No one's laughing. Okay, it's going to be a tough crowd, Dave. But we are, because it is your right as a taxpayer and a citizen to go ahead and appeal your property assessment if you believe it is done or improperly assessed or you believe the value is inaccurate. So it is your right as a citizen to do that. So we want to make sure that you have that opportunity and you have the information you need to do so. So let's talk a little bit about the handouts you have. The first one is this, let's go look at this big handout here. And it's kind of an eye chart up on the screen, so I'm not going to test you on it, but you have it in front of you. But on here is every municipality inside of Oakland County and who the assessing officer is. Why is that? Is because the first person you should be asking the question of why your assessment is a certain way, or why the value has been derived a certain way, is your property tax assessor. Because they can make changes to the assessment prior to you having to go to the March board review. Okay? Sure. Because if you call that number in Oakland County, the question was, why didn't we add the names of all the Oakland County people that are handling each assessing unit? Because if you call that number, we make sure whether that person's busy or not that someone answers your call. So we use multiple people to handle multiple entities of government throughout the county. So we cross-train our folks. So if you call that number, they'll get you to the right person or another person that can help you get your question answered. Okay? Excellent. So that information, yes?
So a lot of the error shows this OC equalization.
Oakland County Equalization is the assessor for many local units of government here in Oakland County. How many now, Dave?
32.
32 assessing units are covered by the Oakland County Equalization folks. Okay? So that's the information we want you to look at first so that you can go ahead and get those questions answered and hopefully get some help with your individual problem and get it dealt with sooner. Also inside, if you look at the inside of the first page, you'll see a primer on Proposal A. Proposal A was the constitutional amendment that was passed in the mid-90s. That changed the way we assess property in the state of Michigan and how we then allocate taxable values to property and on which your taxes are based on. So Proposal A was the constitutional amendment in 1994. This also has the appeal process in here for you. So if you disagree with your assessment, first thing, obviously, you'll give the assessor a call, see if they can help you. If not, you have the right to appeal to the March Board of Review. And Dave Heber, when he does his part of the presentation, is going to talk to you about what your rights are and what the appeal process is to go through. Also on here, that's something interesting, on page 3, they talk about what's called a hardship. Many folks are struggling. We have a tough economy out there. We get that. If you qualify, you can get a hardship reduction on your property taxes. And that's based on the rules that are set by the local governing body where your home is located. Okay, so it's the city council, township board, and those folks set the rules on how we allocate or how a hardship exemption could be provided through the March Board Review. Okay, so if that's your situation, you know, one of the problems that we've seen over the years is that we do know that people are struggling, but some people are too proud to go and talk to somebody about that. If you're struggling or if you know somebody that is, that would potentially qualify for a hardship, they should go in and talk to the assessing officer or the March Board of Review and try to get that hardship applied to their taxes, okay? So if you know somebody that is, yes, ma'am?
Is there a designated time for that person to go in to seek this hardship, during the year?
All right, so the question was, is there a designated time? There is, and when Dave presents, he's gonna give you the actual timing that everything happens, so hold that question, and he'll give you all that information very soon, okay? So next page, on the back, we have a series of definitions. One of the most difficult parts of our world as assessing officers is making sure we're not using jargon that people do not understand. So there's some definitions of some terminology that we use when we're having that conversation with you to try to figure out what we can do to help. And then always put a picture of your boss on your brochure. And we're going to light up. This is good. We're going to be okay. We're going to try to have some fun too. But so those definitions are important because the hard part is that it is somewhat of a different language, acronyms and terminology that we may use. We want to make sure that we're having an intelligent conversation because understand in the end, our goal is to make sure you totally understand the process under which your value was derived. You may not like it when it's done, but at least if you understand the process, we can have an intelligent conversation to try to solve the problem and to help you through the process. Does that make sense to everyone? So that's what we're going to do, okay? The next handout is this blue brochure. This was sent out in our assessment change notices as well. And this gives some good mathematical examples of how the Proposal A calculations are actually calculated on your property. Now, understand that under Proposal A, and Dave will talk more about this, that we calculate these values for your property every year. So there are new calculations made on every property every year, and they're based on these mathematical examples. There's also some information similar to what we have in your handout that talks about some, it goes into more detail about what assessed value is, what cap value, taxable value in the process that we go through. Okay? Again, our goal is to provide you as much information as we can so that when we have that conversation, we can have an intelligent conversation and hopefully help you through. Okay? So at this point, what I'm going to do is we're going to talk a little bit about I didn't keep open my slide. This is the agenda for this evening's presentation. So the first thing we're going to do, you're going to get an Assessing 101 class. We're going to try to give you some information about how these values are derived and the rules that promulgate that. One more thing before I go beyond that is the rules that we use for the assessing process are from the state of Michigan. The State Tax Commission promulgates the rules and they adhere to the General Property Tax Act. So it's not like the rules for assessing are different here in Oakland County than they are anywhere else in the state of Michigan. Okay? Values may be different, but the rules are the same. The next, we're going to talk about the consumer price index or the inflation rate multiplier, and that's how we work up the cap value. Homestead exemptions, for those of you that this is your principal residence, are entitled to homestead exemptions. So Dave will talk more about that. And then he will go through the process of how to appeal your assessment. Again, your right to do so, and we want to make sure that you can be successful if need be. So there's a number of issues underneath there. We'll open it up for general questions, but then these folks, again, I want to remind you, if you have an individual question in regard to your assessment, we have a number of folks from the Oakland County Equalization Division that are here to answer those questions for you, okay? And we will stay here, and you can line up to see them. We're going to stay here until we talk to all of you that want to be to have that conversation, okay? So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Dave Heber, our manager of equalization. He's going to take you through the process. Thank you.
First of all, I'd like to ask for you to write down questions that you may have on a particular slide, because some of the questions that have already come up, I'm going to hopefully cover as we go through it. Write the page number down on the slide, and I'll go back to them, or Phil will go back to them, whoever's answering questions. We can go back and talk about a particular slide. What I don't want to do is have my portion get bogged down with questions when people just want to hear it and maybe ask a personal question in the back and then get on to the rest of their evening. So if I can just get through this, I'm going to try to go through it. There's a lot of detail. Assessing 101 in 40 minutes or less is not easy to put together, but we want to try to give you a general overview of what we do, how we place your assessments, and then we'll go from there. So just write down the slide that you don't understand or you want to go back to, or the topic, and we'll talk about that at the end, either in general questions or individually, whatever is best for you. First of all, how many people are here have made appeals to the Board of Review in the past, just by show of hands? How many people have appealed their assessment at a Board of Review in the past? So about a third of the people, maybe? Quarter? Any Board of Review members here in any of the communities? People that sit on the Board of Review? Okay. Just more curiosity for my own information. First of all, change of assessment notice. Most people should have received the change of assessment notice. If you haven't received it on your property, there's probably a problem with the address or a mailing issue. So if you have not received a change of assessment notice on a particular property that you own and you believe you should have, then contact your assessor in the handout and find out why you didn't receive your notice to begin with. But what it does is a couple of real important pieces of information of the dates and times of the Board Review and the number to call to make an appointment with that for that Board Review. They're all different. Each community may set different dates and times based on their city charter or the size of their community. So make sure you pay attention to the dates and times so you don't let that lapse in the event you want to make an appeal. There's some valuations on there. The SEV, or the state equalized value, represents half of fair market value. So that is 50% of what the assessor believes the property is worth. So if it's $50,000, the assessor believes your property to be worth $100,000. The taxable value is the amount that you pay taxes on, and I'm going to try to cover some examples of how taxable value works under Proposal A as well. And then down towards the bottom, it has the principal residence exemption. If it's your home that you live in, and it's your principal residence, That should say 100% on the change of assessment notice. And if it doesn't, you need to contact your assessing office and find out why it doesn't, because that can exempt up to 18 mils of school operating tax on a property. So those are some real important factors on the notice themselves. Some other housekeeping items. Phil kind of talked about this. Proposal A, it was a constitutional amendment in 1994. It governs how property taxes were calculated. And what Proposal A did was it put a cap on the increase of taxable value. So taxable value can only go up the CPI or the inflation rate or 5%, whichever is less every year. So when we passed this as voters, property values were going up at double-digit rates in many cases, so people were getting taxed out of their homes. And we voted on this proposal to put a cap on the amount of increase in property taxes while the market was going up. Now, obviously, for a lot of properties over the last 4 or 5 years, there's been significant reductions in property values, and really the cap hasn't been as much of an issue. But barring new construction or an ownership transfer, the maximum amount that your property should have gone up in taxable value for this year is 2.4%. And that's calculated by the inflation rate multiplier or the consumer's price index. That's given to your local assessor by the state tax commission. Phil talked about the state tax commission promulgating rules for assessors to follow. And we get a bulletin from the state to use the statewide for the inflation rate multiplier. Your board review can't use something less than that if you have a newspaper article saying CPI was something different than 2.4%, or the 2.4 is given by the state tax commission. That is the inflation rate multiplier for 2013. The assessor board or your city council cannot change that. And then just a history of since the vote in 1994 and the passage of Proposal A, what the inflation rate multiplier has been since 1995 through 2013. You notice that it was a high in 2009 of 4.4% and as low as deflationary in 2010 is -0.3%. This presentation is on our website. You have the link on our website in the handout, so you'll be able to go back and refer to any of this or print out any pages you want. You don't have to try to copy all of this down. And we're also videoing the presentation, so if you want to, you can watch it again later, but if nothing else, it'll be out on our website. A couple of excerpts of the General Property Tax Act are in here, and this is usually part of the most confusing portion from a taxpayer perspective versus an assessor perspective. The General Property Tax Act says that true cash value means the usual selling price. It doesn't mean the exact selling price of a particular parcel. The assessor's responsible for taking sold properties to value the entire population of parcels. So that's what we do in a mass appraisal method, is we use the sold properties to value all the properties. We don't simply take a sale price, divide it by two, and assess that property that way. And that's what most people, when we go do these seminars or they talk to people in the community, they think that the assessor taxes you at half of what you paid, and that's all there is to it. Well, your sale will fall into a group of sales that we use to value all the properties. And I'm going to walk you through some examples of that as we go forward. In fact, the Tax Commission issued a bulletin in 1997 down at the bottom of the screen there that it prohibits an assessor from raising assessments to half of what someone pays or reducing assessments to half of what someone pays. It has to fall into the group of sales that we're using, and I'm going to show you how that works as we go forward. There's a couple examples of how the SEV and taxable value can increase and how the cap would work to help suppress the amount of taxes that can be levied on a particular parcel. In this example, this property still had, and I don't know how many people are familiar at all with Proposal A, but we'll go through a couple of these, where when values were going up exceedingly high in the mid part of the 90s and early part of the 2000s, the the taxable value was kept in check at the inflation rate by the CPI. So we had a higher SCV and a lower taxable value. So in this case, the property value last year was at $200,000, and the assessor determines this year it's at $220,000. So they raise the assessor raises the assessment by $10,000, but the taxable value is capped down at that $81,920. So that's an example where the market's going up higher than inflation, and a property owner is receiving benefit of proposal A's cap. The next example shows what a lot of people have experienced over the last several years, where we're in a declining valuation and the market has actually dropped significantly down, and the taxable value, the taxpayer is paying taxes on the SCV itself. So it's a dollar for dollar reduction when the property values fall. So it just depends on how long somebody's owned a property and how many years they've had a cap on it under proposal A, and how far the market has either increased or decreased. And these examples are in here to be on our website as illustration. They're in the blue packet or the pamphlet as well. And this is more of the individual question. If you don't understand these examples, I mean, I'd be glad to try it again, or we'd be glad to try it again in general questions. But if you ever notice, we can certainly talk, your staff can talk to you here tonight, or we can make an appointment with you at some other point. But they're in here, they're going to be on the website, and again, we can hit them in questions. The homestead exemptions, again, Phil kind of hit on this a little bit earlier. This is just an important thing to look at on your notice, important item to check. If you're not receiving 100% homestead or PRE exemption, and you do live there and you vote there, and that's your main residence, you don't have another residence somewhere else that you're claiming a PRE on, make sure you contact your assessors. It's very common that people do not file the appropriate paperwork, and we need to put that on and give you the appropriate tax relief from the millage rate standpoint for the schools that you deserve on that property. So you've got your notice in your hands. You may understand a little bit of it as far as what the assessor thinks your property's worth. You may not. What's the first thing that we think you should do as a taxpayer? And the number one thing is, you know, come to a seminar like this that we're putting on and contact your assessor. If we don't clear up your questions, or we're not your assessor, or again, someone asked about the staff that we have assigned to each unit, and if that's the individual you want to talk to, or a lot of times it's the most appropriate person, we'll make that contact. Call them, tell them that you came to this and you've got some questions that came up during the seminar and you'd like some assistance with it. I mean, I can guarantee it from our staff at the county that we'd be glad to talk with you and meet with you regarding your assessment. And I can pretty much vouch for the rest of the assessors in the county too, that they're all professional people. They want to do the right thing as far as valuing the properties, and that's what we're trying to do. So when you're talking to the assessor, what might you want to do? We always suggest, and again, we're geared more towards residential here, but to review your property record card. Every property, your assessor will keep a record card on. It'll have a sketch, usually a photograph, and square footage calculations of how the assessment was arrived. If the garage would be priced separately from the two-story portion, and any deck or porches would be illustrated separately as well, as the sample would show. Some items that you would want, and this is not an all-inclusive list, but some items that you would want to make sure that you review, maybe your land size. Is the land size is correct on the appraisal record card? The square footage of the building, the assessors measure from the exterior of the building, we do that on all properties. Classification of construction. This is a subjective determination by the assessor, where A is the best construction, and D is the most low-cost construction, and B and C fall in between. You want to make sure that your garage is calculated separately, and the number of bathrooms, and there's some other items up there that you can get on your own. But these are just some ideas of what you may want to look at. If it's an acreage parcel, you might want to make sure if there's some wetlands on it, that the appropriate number of wetland acres, or lakefront, the front foot of waterfront. And this is just an idea of looking at your record and getting an understanding of how the assessor is valuing your property.
Excuse me, how do you get access to that?
Okay. I'm going to go through that in just a little bit. Hang on. for setting the values, and I got to kind of build on this, I understand it's a very good question, that setting the values, we're required to use either a one-year sales study if the market is declining, or a two-year sales study in an increasing market. The dates illustrated from October 1, 2011, and the one-year study, or October 1, 2010, are rules promulgated by the State Tax Commission. So what we do is we look at the sales in that time frame, compare those to the assessments of the properties that sold. So we do an analysis, and I have an example of that as well. And we determine whether the market's going up and assessments need to be increased, or they're going down and need to be further decreased. So that's the time frame that we're going to be working in. So when the market was dropping at, in many cases, double digits, and some communities still double-digit rates, when we looked at that snapshot of time and we mailed the assessment notice out, we always lag behind the market, either in an increasing market or a decreasing market. So, but that's the system as it is for mass appraisal for property taxes, and then the appeal process is the next portion of that. So, so here's what we do, again, an attempt to explain it to you in hopefully 30 minutes or less. This is an example of Milford Township. You look at we break up the community, what we call neighborhoods. Neighborhoods could be geographic, like you live in Briarwood neighborhood or whatever the name of your neighborhood is, or it could be a particular geographic area by style. So the neighborhood might be all the ranches south of 13 Mile, or all the colonials that are in a particular community that are north of 12 Mile. It just, that's again, the assessor's determination of how they feel the most comparable properties to value for mass appraisal purposes. But quite often residential, they are geographic of some form, and then they might be broken down by age or some other subset after geographics. So if you look up at the upper left-hand portion, we've got a circle around a particular neighborhood, and we'll just blow that up and take a look at it. The shaded in green are all the parcels located within that neighborhood that the assessors determined that these properties are similar enough that we're going to use the sales in there to value all the properties. What we do is we look at the sold properties. And these properties indicated in red are the ones that have sold within the correct time frame. And what we do is we make an analysis of the sold properties, the sale price, compared to the assessed value. And again, in a perfect world, everything would be at 50% of fair market value, and we would never adjust the assessments at any point in time. But that's not how the real estate market works. It's either going up or going down. You know, sometimes it's flat, but it is changing over time. What we do is we look at that division step of dividing the sale price into the assessment, or come up with a ratio. And perfectly, it would be at 50%, but again, it's not perfect. You'll notice in the sale type, and I'm going to talk about this in a little bit too, there's a couple of bank sold properties mixed in with the sales study, because that's a common question that we're going to get here in a little bit, is what do we do with all the foreclosures? So those are bank sold properties. We make the calculation that the State Tax Commission says anything between 49 and 50 is considered to be assessed at 50% of market value. So they give us that leeway in setting assessments by community to be between 49 and 50. We make the calculation just by dividing the 49 to 50 by the ratio of 46.93 and come up that the assessments need to be increased on average of 6% in this particular geographic neighborhood. If you look at the top sale, they're already over 50%. So when we put another 6% on top of it, it goes up even higher. We recognize that when we do it. We are bound by using mass appraisal techniques by the state. We do the best job we can to do this. But it doesn't always work for each particular property type. And that's when we get into the board review or talking to your assessor, what you might do to assist you in making a challenge to the value. So what we do here is we've added the 6%. The end ratio is at 49.15, so we're within the parameters allowed by the state. And again, there's some properties that are below 50 on an individual basis of what, from what they paid, and there's some that are that exceed the 50%. But we apply that same 6% to all the parcels. If I roll back all of them, not just the sold ones. You're just seeing the analysis of the sold ones or how we do that. Then the what would be incorrect is doing what most or a lot of people think we do, is we just divide the sale price by two, change the assessment, and there's the increase of almost 7%, the decrease of 7%. That's just valuing sold properties, and it would be easy to get 50%, but that's not what we're in fact, that's prohibited by statute and by state tax commission rules.
Excuse me, how can you evaluate a property that's not been sold?
What's that? How there's a question, how can I evaluate a property that's not been sold? Well, that happens all the time, and we do it every year, that we're compelled to do that annually. It's just like if you're going to go get a mortgage, the appraiser comes out and values your property that's not been sold. They value it for you, so they have their opinion of what the property is worth, so you can hopefully get a loan on it. We have an opinion of what the property is worth, so hopefully we can administer the property tax system fairly. But no, we do value all properties, sold or not, every year. Next example is the same type of thing. This is Madison Heights. Again, we'll boil down to a neighborhood. In this case, it shows that the properties are overvalued and a reduction is required to bring the assessments down to be between 49 and 50. This time we're using the one-year sales study. That's more advantageous to the taxpayer in a declining market. It helps us recognize the losses faster than if we're using a two-year sales study in a declining market. That's why the state did that. We make the reduction to the assessments, what was the percentage, around 8%, to be down between 49 and 50 again. Again, there's one bank sale on this sample, and that is applied to the entire population of parcels. So that's basically how we do it in residential assessments for the year-over-year changes. In a declining market, we use a one-year, and there's roughly, I want to say maybe 8 to 10 communities of the 53 that are still declining. The rest of them are either flat or experiencing increases.
They're using 2 years.
They're using 2 years in those, correct.
Excuse me, the example you just said is a true case? The example you just showed us.
Actually, this was a true case last year. When we did this presentation, we just changed the dates on it for this year. So this was a true case last year.
I thought it's like 2.4% for all Oakland Township, right? If the ownership doesn't change, and the property, the SEV is like 2.4% raise.
The cap on the taxable value would be 2.4% if the ownership doesn't change or there was no new construction.
But how about those?
We're simple. That's just the value. We can drop the values as much as we want. There's a lot of people in this room that have seen significant reductions in their property values, as illustrated on their change of assessment notices. So I don't quite follow.
If the ownership doesn't change, I thought everybody got like 2.4% raise for the FDA.
No, we haven't been raised. There's been taxable value has been decreasing within the county-wide, so we have not been seeing increases in taxable value on tolls. Let me go through this, and we'll talk to you in general questions, because I don't really want to hit it for everybody in here, but let me get through this. So how does the assessor do it? This is a little bit, if you're really into understanding this, the assessor can do it by really one of two different ways. You can adjust the land value or the building value or both. So that's where there's two components to your assessment. So you may want to know if you are lakefront property, how much your lot's being assessed at versus how much you're building. But that's what your assessor will do, is they'll make adjustments to the land or the building to come up with what they believe the true cash value is for the given year. This year it's 2013. Foreclosures. This is a bar graph of the number of bank foreclosed properties from 2000 through 2012. You'll notice that early part of the, or in the year 2000, there's less than 1,000, there's 820 bank foreclosures. and that number escalated and hopefully peaked at the 9,290 in 2010. That represented one in every 51 properties countywide. 2012 or 2011, we saw some improvement to that, but and in 2012, there's further improvement. We're down to 5,108. Still a significant number of bank foreclosures to be almost at 2006 rates for bank foreclosures. So again, we do look at that. We are aware of the number of foreclosures in the market. And then what do we do with them when the bank sells a property? Again, the tax commission.
I have a question about CPI. CPI, you did your computer part of that major difference in CPI that they use? And the CPI from the federal government.
Well, I'll go back to that slide as soon as we're done going through it. It is in here, and we can go into that in a little bit more detail. The tax commission promulgates rules for assessors to file and guidelines for using bank-sold properties within our study. We look at a bank-sold property really the same way we would any other sale. We look at whether it was on the market by a knowledgeable real estate person. We look at whether it was in normal condition for that market. We look at how long was it on the market? Was it sold, put on the market and sold in 1 or 2 days? Well, that could be have an effect on the price. We send out questionnaires in many cases to the buyers of bank sold properties. Not all cases, but in many cases, to come up with was there any damage? I mean, we can't always get into the properties. Did the pipes freeze and break? Was there actual physical damage to the property? When we do that review, we determine to the best of our ability whether it was a good arm's length transaction and a good representative sale for similar type properties. And if we determine that, we include them in the study. If we determine that it's not, then we would exclude that. We're required to exclude those from the study. So that's what we do. Example, two pictures at the top, they look fairly similar properties. The one on the left, we may leave that bank sold property in the study. The picture on the right, where the appliances and the kitchen cabinets are removed, that would come out of the study by virtue of not having being a finished home or being damaged or whatever you want to consider. So we do the best we can to inspect the properties and to find out what happened in each real estate transaction. So, but when you get down to the board review, you may know a little bit more about one particular sale or two particular sales that would help you in building your case. So we'll cover that in just a couple seconds here. This is the change in value from 2007, a residential, through 2013. This is what we've experienced on average countywide for 2008, 9, 10, 11, 12, as the bar graph goes on. Obviously, the worst year was 15.5% countywide. That will vary by community. Some would be more than that, some less than that. And this year, we are expecting a 1% increase in value, in actual SEVs. The market value went up by about 1%.
Is that value in comparison to the previous year?
Correct.
That up in just 1 second.
No.
Okay.
You know, if I could mention too, is that the video and the PowerPoint are all going to be online afterwards as well. So all the data that we're providing for you, we're going to put up online on our website as well.
Is that going to be on Oakland.gov?
Yeah, Oakland.com.
It's in the handbook as well.
Yeah.
This is the change in residential value for residential values by community. Cities are on the left, townships are on the right, that are for 2013. This does not mean that every parcel in Auburn Hills went up 0.57%. That's not what we've talked about so far tonight. That's not what I'm saying now. Doesn't mean Berkeley, everybody went up 2.92%. This is the community totals for residential property values. Some neighborhoods may go up in excess of the average, and some may go down even if the community is experiencing increases. This is just the average by community.
Yeah.
So should these average to 1%?
Mathematical average of these, it would be inappropriate because you would weigh Troy the same amount as you would weigh a small community like Clarkston. So when you add up all the, when you add up all the sales in total, a weighted average of the 1% is where it comes from.
Thank you.
You bet.
Change in value is due to a change in CPI?
No, this is value change. CPI would be the same everywhere. 2.4% would be the CPI. So what we're saying is values in Auburn Hills went up 0.57%. Berkeley, values were going up 3.92%.
Based on?
Based on sales within the appropriate time frame.
Okay.
So the board review. If you, again, we're going to go through just some housekeeping, and then we're going to show you what we think, the best way we think to make an effective challenge to board review. Board review meets three times a year. March is the time that they will hear taxpayer challenges to valuations. They also meet in July and December. Many boards of review will hear poverty exemptions in July and December, or they're for administrative changes. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about poverty in just a second. Administrative changes would be where we make a mistake in valuing something where we have you as a two-story house when you're really a one-story house. We can correct that in July and December. Or if you don't have your appropriate principal residence exemption, we can do that at that time as well. But the main focus for this meeting is that you're not happy with your valuation. You've talked to the assessor, and the assessor, you have an honest disagreement about the value. So what do? You want to make an appointment with the board review and make an appeal with that board review. Who can be on the board? This is, again, we'll leave up there. Basically, they're made up of three-member panels. They're residents in your community. They're your peers. They're your neighbors. They're appointed by the city council or the township board to serve on the board review. Most of them are volunteer positions. Some of them, they may get a stipend of $30 to $50 a day, depending on the community. It's not a paid position. It's an appointed position by your city governing body. The statute says at least two-thirds of them shall be property taxpayers in the community. I'm not aware of any that we do that not all three people just live in the community, and that's who you base your appeal to. So how do you prepare for board review? Couple of common things that we like someone to ask themselves, what do you think your property is worth? That's the question that the board's going to ask you, that's the question your assessor's going to ask you, is what do you really think your property is worth? Not that you don't like the CPI, or not that you don't like the amount you're paying in taxes. What do you, we understand those factors, but what do you think your property is worth? And then what are you basing that opinion on? And we're going to show you how we've already kind of shown you how the assessment process works, and there is some inherent flaws in doing mass appraisal and making adjustments by neighborhood. We're going to show you how to base an individual appeal by gathering your own sales. Newspaper articles that are going to quote the totals from, the assessor was quoted in the paper saying that the Auburn Hills is going up 0.57% and you went up 2% in Auburn Hills, that's not going to be a basis for a successful appeal. So the newspaper articles are informational for you and really not very helpful in a board review setting. That's just some advice that we're trying to give as well. So where do you find sales data? And this goes to one of the gentleman's questions there about the record card. It's kind of the same place. You can get it from your assessing office. Call your assessing office, go to your assessing office. You can get it from, you can get sales information from realtors. Property Gateway is a county system here that has some free information as well. The County Register of Deeds has information as far as sold properties that you can obtain information there as well. The best place to get started, at least in our opinions, is our website. Looking at the sheet, Dev, how many people's assessor says Oakland County Equalization? And the handout you have, how many people are that we do the assessing, or Oakland County does the assessing? I bet you it's most of them. We sent out 206,000 invites to this. We put our assessment information online. If you go to our website, it's in your handout, and search by your community, we'll get, we have a form out there that gives all the sold properties, a map of all the sold properties, similar to what you saw on the screen. And then we take component information from the appraisal record card, like the square footage or the age of the property, and we put it on the website. So you can start doing your own research at home. You don't have to go into the assessing office. You can do it, you know, whatever time's convenient for you. You don't have to do it during our business hours. And we put that out there so you can start the process of looking at what other properties are assessed for, what they've sold for, and again, how we put the, not all the information from the record card, but we put enough on there to get started. And you know that the house was built in whatever year, and it's 2,000 square feet. So we put that out there, and that's the best place to start, is to look at our website and get an idea of what's sold in your neighborhood, what the assessments are, and how that compares to your own individual property.
Do we need to place that house information?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
We need to pay to get all the information. No. It's free?
This is free. This is on our website right now. We put it out there every year in February and March for this process for taxpayers to make challenges to their assessment. And then it becomes stagnant data that we take down after the board review process. Because if you went in and successfully challenged, the information on that PDF would be incorrect. So we're not going to real-time update it. This is a snapshot of the data when we sent the notices to you. And it's out there for your use to try to base, one, an opinion whether you think an appeal is warranted, and then two, if it is, to help you to try to be as successful as you can in your appeal.
Do you take up a bigger area? Like, say, I got some property in the village of Lake Orion City, and there was no sales of vacant property. There are a few lots there, but they went. But when I went for the board review, they said, "Well, there was no sale," and so I was wondering if there's a different criteria for lake property. Like say, for example, can you take in Lakeville's area or so on? For that kind of thing.
I think the question is, if there's not sales data in your general area and similar to your situation, can you broaden your specter of looking for data to compare it to? Is that?
Yeah, that's it, because there's not too many places that have vacant land.
I agree. There's a number of places that a vacant lot would be a very difficult piece of property to come up with actual comparable sales on. You know, you could broaden your specter on that, and we could also start looking at there'll be a reasonable ratio of land value to building value, even in a developed community. So if you're in the city of Berkeley, you wouldn't expect to have a $200,000 house where the houses in the neighborhood are selling for $200,000 and a vacant lot assessment indicating that the lot's worth $175,000. That would be a ridiculous ratio. So there are some benchmark ratios that your assessor can work with you on. And a lakefront would be higher than that. In some cases, the land's worth more than the building, and it might be worth more without a building on it in some cases. So those are, if you can't find it on here, the specific information, I suggest you make an appointment with your assessor, and you approach that question to them, you know, at their office and say, you know, I want to see some sales to help me out as to what my properties were. How do I do that?
Yeah, there was another thing. There was some property that was vacant right next to us, and it's a little bit larger, but the square footage of this vacant land was less than ours. And they said you have to go strictly based on sale. You can't even consider anything else. So
I can't vouch for what was said in that conversation. The only thing I can say is I think you should talk to the assessor. The board review member told you that. I wasn't there, but talk to your assessor and ask them, what can I use to, what are you using to value my property? What would you use to defend this value if it's something you need like that?
Do you know where increased market? Is there 2 years worth of data on there? Go back 2 years, mm-hmm. or just
Yeah, yes. So that's one, you know, that's the most suggested route that we feel you should go, starting there. It's not, you know, all-inclusive, and you may want to go further than that. Property gateway, this is another county product. Some of the information on property gateway is out there for a fee. Some of it's out there for free. I'd suggest looking at what we have first from a taxpayer's perspective. But property gateway is a little more map-driven, and you might be a little bit better off. You might be more comfortable using that than you are using our PDFs online. So that's another avenue for free information. So once you get these sales, what do you do with them? I mean, most people have seen a bank or a mortgage appraisal, or at least reviewed one on their own property, where the appraiser goes out, finds two or three comparable properties that have sold, and they lay them out on a grid. And they use those to make a judgment or an opinion of value on your property. That's what we suggest you do, something similar to this. It doesn't have to be this exact way. But lay out your best three comparable sales, or four, or whatever you can find, and make some judgments of your own. Use some common sense. Everyone's going to raise their hand and say, well, what about this and what about that? But use some common sense. If you have a three-car garage, and you find a comparable that's sold, and everything's the same except the comparable only has a two-car garage, well, I think it would behoove you to tell the board review that you realize you've got that three-car garage, so yours is probably worth a little bit more than that property, because the board review will be able to look at that instantly and say, okay, this person isn't going to try to make any adjustments, they're just trying to throw some sales at them, and use some sense as to what you would say. Now, is a third car garage, is it worth $100,000 more? No, absolutely not. Is it worth, depending on where it is? You know your neighborhood, you know your area. A few thousand dollars more, you know, whatever it is. Or a finished basement. If you know that there's a property that yours has a finished basement and something doesn't, or vice versa, make those adjustments. Recognize where you can in your opinion of value that this house is better than mine, or this house is worse than mine, and come up with a reasonable estimate of value using your own good judgment, and present that to the board of review. These are the most successful appeals. The volumes of information, printouts from the realtor friend that are that thick, aren't going to be as good as one concise or two or three concise documents that they can look at and say, okay, well, they've got three sales, they look fairly similar, they're similar in size, there's some differences that they made some allocations for, and the board review is more apt to look at that, and that appeal would be more successful, in our opinion, than just volumes of information.
How far can you go from the site for evaluation of what's reasonable?
However far you need to get good comparable sales. Some neighborhoods, you really won't even need to leave a two or three block area. Some types of property, you might need to leave the community. If your property were at, say, Orchard Lake, you may want to look at lakes in West Bloomfield or Commerce or Lake Angela, something like that. I mean, it depends. So you want to, you know, validate the data, the stuff that our information, it's considered validated. That's really put in there for the Zillow. If you go to Zillow and you're going to try to pull up a value, make sure that the information you double check what you're getting off those online services is accurate with your assessing office. Again, make your presentation concise. The time frame with the board will be limited. Depends on the board. Usually they're 10 to 15 minute appointment windows, which is really a fairly long time to make a case on a single property. If you do your homework, it really shouldn't take that long. And again, the more data isn't always better. One last thing that we've talked about in these presentations is, remember, the board review they didn't do anything to your property. You know, we did as the assessor, being honest. We're the ones that set the value, and they're there to hear the challenge. So to go in there and say that you people did this and that, and those are really unsuccessful challenges when the board review is being attacked by the taxpayer. Again, they're there to listen to it, they try to be objective, they are objective, they try to do the best they can in making independent decisions. So again, your assessor set the value, the board is your appeal mechanism. So I mean, I would, obviously it's always best to be courteous. So,
what do you do when the assessor is sitting next to the board?
when this Saturday, just make your case to the board review. Our staff will be in there listening.
That's to intervene and try to convince them it
should be awarded. Well, a lot of times what will happen, I guess the question is what do you do when the assessor's in there? If somebody came in with a grid something similar to this, and they put three sales on there that were all bank sold properties, you know, and there was another 10 more sales in the neighborhood, that the board's gonna know about all the sales, and so are we. So what we might do in a situation like that is to say to the board review, there's more sales that we think you should look at in that time frame. But we try not to interrupt the taxpayer at all, other than just answer questions at the board, or we would point them out that to the board. So we, in a situation like if that were the case, and they were all the lowest three sales that you could find, and we knew there was damage to one of them or whatever, we would make that, we would point that out to the board, because it wouldn't be fair to your neighbors, you know, if you have received a reduction that really wasn't warranted based on the full picture of that.
And to that point, how do we have these at those buyer's questionnaires that we use to determine whether or not bank sales, good
online
sales, used to
if you have particular bank sales in an area that you want to know what we use, we can share that with you.
So I have to contact the assessors specific for our area to get copies of those buyer questionnaires.
What area is that?
Oakland County.
Okay, that would be our office.
Yes, I am.
Okay. Poverty exemptions. Phil touched on this a little bit. The board review can make reductions based on the taxpayer's ability to pay taxes. I'm not going to go into a ton of detail, but what I think you need to know is that if you or someone you know is in that situation, the board review is the only body that can make a reduction based on someone's ability to pay. So, but a lot of things can be done in March, but more often, because most boards require the taxpayer to file their income tax returns, those returns aren't prepared by the March board review dates. So they will table those to the July board review or the December board review when the taxpayer can turn in all the required documentation. What the board is required to do is to apply an asset test and an income level test, which is adopted by the governing body of the local community. So the city township or the city council or the township board will set the guidelines for income and assets. And the board and the assessor will try to apply those guidelines fairly to the taxpayer, and the taxpayer will receive a reduction based on their ability to pay, or they'll be not denied on the based on their ability to pay. But again, I don't want to get into debating whether I only make this and would I qualify in this meeting. But just know that that's there. If you know someone that are in those circumstances, don't hesitate to ask further questions to your assessor. We have Oakland Township's guideline in here from last year where they have a very detailed example of what one may look like in the county. Where they're looking for income, they'll look for assets on the next page, and then they'll look for expenses in order to determine whether they would fit into that township's criteria for hardship. So again, it's just an example. Every community is required to have one. They'll all be, it could be slightly different. Some of them model off of each other's, but they're there, it's there, you can get it from your local assessing office or your local township office, or you can get them from our office as well if we do the assessing for you. So you go to the board review, you've made your appeal. What happens next? Assessors are required to notify taxpayers by the first Monday in June of the board review's decision. That usually, we send out the letters, and all assessors in the county send out the letters of the board review's response sometime in April. The boards wrap up towards the middle to end of March. Some letters get out at the end of March, but usually if you don't have yours, by mid-April, I would call your assessing office and ask where it is. There's no benefit to us to hang on to these letters until June 3rd in this case. And the board can either no change the assessment, they can lower the assessment, they can lower the taxable value. They can also raise the assessment, the board review as well.
Now,
In that notice, or that response from the Board of Review, there'll be instructions on how to appeal further to the Michigan Tax Tribunal. And I'm going to just briefly cover how the Michigan Tax Tribunal works, which that would be your next step in an appeal process on your property taxes. The Michigan Tax Tribunal for basic for residential properties is usually in the Small Claims Tax Tribunal. It's free. There's no filing fee for your principal residence. And while it's an agency centered in Lansing, the hearings are usually held over in our building on Elizabeth Lake Road that we provide space to the state to use. And it's an administrative law judge that would hear the taxpayer complaints just a little bit more detailed. It's a little bit more formal, where the taxpayer will have around 10 minutes to present their case. The assessor will have around 10 minutes to present their case. And there'll be an exchange where the hearing officer will ask questions of both parties to try to get a clear understanding of what the differences are and the opinions of value. And then they'll make an independent determination as to value as well. You do that by sending a letter to the Tax Tribunal in Lansing. That information will be on your Board Review decision letter. And again, there's no fees for principal residence, and it's not that you have to go to Lansing. A lot of people think you have to go to Lansing. You've got to mail stuff to Lansing, but then you just come over to the office over on Elizabeth Lake Road, usually is where we're at.
So the county assesses, and then the county also moves the tax tribunal.
No, the tax tribunal members are appointed. They're administrative law judges appointed by the governor. In the statute, counties are required to provide space for the hearings. So we provide a conference room, a phone, desk, chairs, and I think they might even use our network or wireless network, the hearing officer does. So we're required to provide space. And then there's adjacent space in our office that they use.
All right, well, thank you all for attending, and good luck with your appeals.